Perhaps. Maybe he would hire a scribe and have someone do the work for him so he'd have his own copy. Either way, he was to have his own personal copy. Let me tell you, you have that privilege, and I want to admonish you. You ought to have a good Bible that's very much your Bible. And you know, I have used different study Bibles over the years. I have an original Scofield Reference Bible I like. My mom has the New Open Study Bible, has a lot of great notes in it. My wife's got the Life Application Bible. The thing is huge. I've had people ask me, what's the best study Bible? Well, understand, the study notes are just a help to you. They are not inspired. So when you say, well, Scofield says, well, that's just one man's observation on the scriptures, okay? The Bible itself is was given by inspiration and kept for us. The notes are a help. But what I mean is you ought to have a Bible that's very much your Bible. You mark it up. You study out of it. You memorize out of it. I remember being in Nova Scotia, was it 3 years ago now, talking to a college-age girl at the back of the auditorium after the service. She and her friend came to see me. She wanted to know how to be saved. I had left my Bible sitting up on the communion table. So I picked up the deacon's Bible, and I was using it to lead this girl to Christ. Now, his is a King James like mine. So it's the same text, but I was lost. Now, why? Same language, everything. Because it wasn't my Bible. What I'm talking about here is you ought to have a Bible that you mark it, you make notes in it. Now, I preach out of this one. This is a nice Thomas Nelson Bible, and it's real soft leather. I took a year to mark it up. This isn't my primary Bible. I use a I use a Cambridge Study Bible. It has wide margin notes so I can make my own notes in the Bible. But I mark it up. Don't be afraid to mark your Bible. When you go to church, you shouldn't be like, anybody know there's a Bible around here? It's where's my Bible? In fact, you shouldn't even have to ask because you read it every day. So make it personal. This is my Bible. I'm to love it. D.L. Moody said, this book will keep you from sin or sin will keep you from this book. Think about that. The devil will do everything in his power. The flesh will do everything it can. The world will despise this book. Everything is against you reading this book. Either sin will keep you from this book or this book will keep you from sin. So make his own copy of the Bible. Then notice in verse 18, we're told, beginning of verse 19, it shall be with him. He shall read therein all the days of his life that he may learn to fear the Lord his God. All right. The second thing, he was not only to make his own copy of the law, he was to meditate daily on God's word. Meditate daily in God's word. Again, Joshua 1:8, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. Okay, day and night, that's daily. Back when I was in high school, I got convicted about the need for daily devotions. When I went to Gloucester County Christian School, some of my friends were talking about devotions, and I said, what are devotions? They said, well, that's where you read the Bible every day. Oh, I came up from a liberal church. I didn't know anything about devotions, so I thought I probably should have devotions. So I just set out, okay, I'll read the Bible every day. Well, have you ever noticed new habits are easier determined than done? I had a goal, but for a week I did okay. And then one day I missed a day, got back on track, read for 4 or 5 days straight, and then I missed 2 days in a row. Then I gave up. Have you ever been there? And so I thought, man, I've got to become consistent reading my Bible. So I thought, well, if I can just find the verse that says, thou shalt read thy Bible every day, that'll solve my problem. Anybody know where the verse is? Well, it doesn't say it that way. Now, do you think that God wants us to read the Bible every day? Yes. How do we know that? Don't just tell me your opinion. How do we know that? Well, I'll tell you how I came to that conclusion. Among other things, Jesus said that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Matthew 4:4. In Matthew 6:11, in the Lord's model prayer, he taught us to pray, give us this day our what? Daily bread. Now, that's talking about physical food. Every day, God designed your body needs food. If you need physical food every day, how much more do you need spiritual food every day? Man shall not live by bread alone. So if he taught us to pray, give us this day our daily bread, then like Job, we can say, Job 23:12, I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. You make time every day to eat. You need to make time every day to read this book. So when I was a high schooler, I made a commitment. I'd heard a preacher give an admonition that changed my life. He said, when I was a young man, I made a vow to God to read the Bible every day. And my first thought was probably like you, ooh, vow. Ooh, be careful, spooky vow. You know, Jephthah, remember the vow, the rash vow, and then offered up his daughter to the Lord's service after that. And ooh, vows, I don't know. Well, wait a minute. I know that Ecclesiastes says better not to vow than to vow and not pay. But think about it. I'm wearing a ring that tells you I made a vow. What kind of vow did I make? That's a marriage vow. Folks, God hasn't changed his mind on that. What God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. When Angela Joy Westberg and I vowed to each other that we would be a wedded couple, it is for a lifetime, till death do us part. That relationship is based on a vow. It's a lifelong commitment. Vows aren't bad. Vows are sacred. When I was a teenager, I was prompted to make a vow to God to read His Word every day. Now, let me tell you why I did this in the area of Bible reading. In Luke chapter 10, 38 to 42, we have the story of Mary and Martha, and Martha's busy serving the Lord, and Mary's seemingly just sitting there. And Martha says, "Lord, don't you care? Bitter, therefore, she helped me." And Jesus answered and said, "Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful. Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her." What was Mary doing? The Bible said she was sitting at Jesus' feet, hearing His word. That's the one needful thing according to Jesus. So I made a vow as a teenager, "Lord, by Your grace, I will never go to bed at night unless I've read the Bible sometime during the day." But here's what I said. I will read the Bible at least 5 minutes a day. Now you might say, 5 minutes? That's just like a joke out of 24 hours. The purpose of my vow was to establish consistency in quiet time. What I found was 5 minutes soon became 10, became 15, became 20. There were days when I was a junior in high school, I would read the Bible an hour and a half a day, and no one was compelling me to do so. I'd become habitual in my devotions, and I was enjoying it. Every one of us needs a commitment to personal quiet time. We need to meditate daily in God's Word. And interestingly, I've been quoting Joshua 1:8, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth." Some of you may say, "Well, I read the Bible every day, but sometimes I don't get much out of it." I learned something as a high schooler the next year that just gave me a perspective on what personal quiet time is all about. I was on a trip to England and Scotland. It was a missionary trip in the summer of 1982. And I was just before my sophomore year. We met a pastor over in Scotland named Pastor Leslie Roberts. He was a 70-year-old Nazarene pastor. He wore the black robe with the clerical collar. And when he had learned that we were young people from the United States on a mission trip, he said, "You know, young people, I found that if you're not consistently taking in, you're not very adept at giving out." He says, "Has anyone taught you how to meditate in the Word of God?" Well, you know, in meditating, I was new to a fundamental church. And to me, meditating was something that shaved-headed Buddhist monks would do out in the field, you know, and try to empty their mind of worldly clutter. He said, "Meditating is not emptying your mind. It's filling your mind with God's truth, and it's chewing the cud of that truth." He said, "The term comes from animals that ruminate." He said, "You know what it means to ruminate, don't you? Chew the cud." He said, "Now, what animals ruminate?" And somebody said, "Well, cows." He said, "Aye, that's true, cows do." He said, "Something else. And you've seen them all over Scotland. You've seen them down there in England. Sheep meditate. They ruminate. They chew the cud." And he said, "What it means is to chew the cud is you take the Word of God and you think on it and you think on it. You mull it over in your mind." In fact, he gave this analogy. He said, "Let's take a familiar verse. We'll do Psalm 23, why don't we? The Lord is my shepherd." He said, "Now you get thinking about that there, and it's you break it down just like a ruminating animal would break down the cud. So you take it word by word, phrase by phrase. Let's start with, 'The Lord is my shepherd.' Now, young people, who is the Lord?" Someone said, "Well, God." He said, "Ah, that's true. But think deeper with me. The Lord is my shepherd." You know, there in your Bible, it's all in capital letters. And in our Bible, when you see the Lord's name in all capitals, that's the personal name. What is that name? Jehovah. I am that I am. The I am that I am is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And you think about that. The Bible gives us terms like Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. He gives us terms like Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is our peace. And you start meditating on it, that I am is my shepherd. Someone said, "Well, isn't that also Jesus? Because Jesus in the New Testament is Jehovah in the Old Testament." He said, "Aye, and that's why he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the bread of life. I am the water of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the good shepherd. The I am is my shepherd." Somebody said, "Well, he's also a wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." He said, "I, the Lord, is my shepherd." Then you go to the next word. Now, it's a wee little word there. It's the little linking verb is. Verb of being. The Lord is my shepherd. He said, now it's a present verb. He's not saying that someday when I get mature enough and stable enough in my Christian walk, the Lord will be my shepherd. He is my shepherd. It's not like, well, I used to walk with God, but he abandoned me, and now he was. No, he is my shepherd. He said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Then he went to the next word. He said, now you look at the next word, the Lord is my shepherd. He said, young people, This is why you need to know the English language. What form of speech is that there? What part of speech? And someone said, preposition. Ha ha! He said, good, you're off school for the summer and you even remember that. That's good. He said, my is a personal possessive pronoun. And personal, individual, possessive, dealing with ownership. He's saying he is my shepherd. He's not just me mom and dad's shepherd. He's not just the pastor's shepherd. He's my shepherd. Then you go to the next word. The Lord is my shepherd. He said, now what does a shepherd do, young people? Someone said, well, they lead the sheep. He says, aye, he leadeth me. Oh, blessed thought. Yeah, have you seen God lead you? Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him and he shall direct thy paths. So he leads me. What else does a shepherd do? Someone said, well, they protect the sheep. Aye. He says, you know, the thief comes not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy, but the Lord, our good shepherd, will beat off the attacking predator. In fact, the Bible says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, he will flee from you, because the Lord is your shepherd. Someone says, well, they lead the sheep to where there's water and food. He says, aye, he prepareth a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Someone said, well, they shear the sheep. He said, that's true. They get that big coat of wool on them, and, you know, the shepherd comes in with the shears and starts clipping off the wool. He says, and the Bible says, we're to lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Have you ever been encumbered by something that's just weighting you down, and the Lord freed you from it? That's what the shepherd does. Someone said, well, I heard that if a little lamb goes wandering off, that not only will the shepherd go seek the sheep, but if it's a perennial problem of keep wandering, they actually break the lamb's leg and carry it until the leg sets and it bonds a shepherd, bond with the shepherd and the sheep. He said, aye, that's true. And whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. Young people, that's what it means to meditate in the Word of God. I've never forgotten that. In fact, whenever I say the word meditate, because it means to ruminate, I grew up working on a dairy farm in Mullica Hill, New Jersey, and I think of cows. And so I say the word meditate like this, meditate. That helps me to remember what the word means, meditate. Now, I want you to remember it, so I'm going to have you say that with me, all right? I'm going to have you think, and I will tell you, I'm going to watch, and if you don't say it, solo time. We'll bring you up, and you can perform for everyone, all right? Because I want you to get this. So we're all going to say, meditate. Ready? Meditate. Some of you act like you rehearsed for that before. That was really good. To meditate is to chew the cud of truth. It's to take the Word of God and think it through. My pastor gave me a simple little formula for meditating years ago. This might help you. A, B, C. A is analyze. When you read the passage, mull it over. Analyze it. Break it down. B is best verse. Let's say you read 3 chapters a day, reading through your Bible. What one verse that you read really stood out to you? That's the one you want to go back and meditate on. So A is analyze, B is best verse, C is commit. What will you commit to do based on what you read? A, B, C, analyze, best verse, commit. I keep a notebook, and each day I jot down basic devotional thoughts. And, you know, this very message grew out of that study time. I was comparing Deuteronomy 17 with 1 Kings 10. I've seen this corollary between the two passages. And I didn't set out to write a message. God was blessing my own soul with his word, which is usually how my preaching comes about. And then I said, you know, that's going to help others too. And it comes from, Jonathan Edwards' father taught him, do your thinking with a pen in hand. Simple little thoughts can become profound observations by just writing out your thoughts. So, A was to make his own copy of the law. B was to meditate daily in God's word. And then last, he was to mind the teachings of God's truth. Notice this in Deuteronomy 17, middle of verse 19. They may learn to fear the Lord as God, to keep all the words of this law and these statutes, to do them, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren, that he turn not aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left, to the end that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, he and his children in the midst of Israel. All right? In other words, you're not just to know the Bible so you know the Bible. I've known people that would like to impress me with Bible knowledge, but it didn't impress me because I didn't see it translated into life. It didn't translate into practice. You know, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin, James 4:17. Be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves, James 1:22. See, we're to make our own copy, make it personal. We're to meditate daily, and then we're to mind the teachings of God's truth. That's what the king's supposed to do. If you know Christ as Savior, this practice of getting into the Word of God, this practice of letting the Word of God get in you, this practice of living out the Word of God will literally transform